today we're going to discuss the importance of British fashion and what place London has on the international fashion scene. We're also going to talk to two talented designers and see some of the British creations that the rest of the world look for in London. But first, let me welcome back Prudence Glynn, fashion editor of The Times. Well, Prudence, I always thought it was Paris as a great centre of fashion. Has London ever been a great centre?
I think Paris, you've got to accept, is the centre of fashion for all sorts of reasons, which are fairly historically recorded now. But of course London's got a place, and a very important one. The thing about London is it's different. We can now offer something which is different. But if I just go quickly through the history of the fashion industry in this country, you know, during the war we were thrown back on our own resources, and we did discover quite surprising talents. Hardy Amys, Norman Hartnell, usually think of for the royal frock. In actual fact, they turned out marvellous designs for you and I to make out of utility patterns and from 3.5 yards of material. After the war, we began to look at Paris again. The new look, I suppose, is when everybody's wardrobe who was an age to wear it. There's rather a nice story, actually, I don't know if you know this one, Mary, about the new look. When the journalists all came back from Paris, Stafford Cripps was so anxious to reserve the country's supplies of material that he told everyone they shouldn't write about it. But women are women. So, of course, in the next year, the new look must have been the most widely copied design, I suppose, ever made. Perfect example, you know, of what women want to wear.
I suppose when one thinks about London as a fashion centre, one thinks about the swinging 60s. I mean, that's when it sort of came into its own, didn't it?
Yes, rather in two ways from our point of view. See, in 1948, we began this tremendous system of art education. The Royal College of Art opened its doors to fashion students, caused a terrible drama, because everyone thought they'd be long-haired weirdies making frocks instead of sort of getting MA degrees for something serious like sculpture. Anyway, we got all these young people, and in the 60s, they really were making a name, and I suppose Mary Quant is the name which everybody associates with the 60s. We got a rather nasty reputation for bad deliveries and bad make, but at long last I think we're coming together now with much higher quality, and we've got 6 or 7 people in this country who really make international news.
Do we have our own fashion shows as they do in Paris?
Yes. We show over here what's called British Fashion Week, and it's actually about British fashion 3 days. I think we show at the wrong time. I think we ought to show before Paris, or certainly between Milan and Paris. But that's an argument that's been going on for ages.
But what do they look for? What is the British look that everybody wants?
There's no one particular style. I mean, funnily enough, having been famous for tailoring clothes, we've become famous for evening dresses. As a matter of fact, this isn't an evening dress. This is a self-sufficiency, I suppose, a recognition, if you like, that back to the land. This is a dress designed by Laura Ashley, who has shops all over the world now. And she intends it for day wear. I feel strange in it.
Well, I've got a Jeff Banks suit on, which you persuaded me to wear, and I must say I do feel a bit sort of, well, a bit drowned.
I think you ought to put the collar up, Mary.
Yes, and that makes a bit stout.
Yes. Well, yes. I mean, I can see what you think, you know. I mean, I feel fairly sort of odd wearing this sort of outfit.
Yes.
But I feel right in it. I feel different, and I think that's very important in fashion.
Right.
But it is quite a serious point that clothes which look very exotic and overdone when they're first shown do filter right down to every level of fashion, every price level. Wendy's clothes, in fact, are never expensive to start with. I think she gives jolly good value for money.
So if our British designers then sell abroad and are very successful, it does make a difference, or it does affect us in the high street.
Very much so. Very much so. Without them, you wouldn't have any nice high street fashion.
Well, we've got a couple of designers here. Mary Arbeid, you've called yourself the best-known unknown designer. Why have you called yourself that?
Well, because I think I've been busy promoting the clothes rather than myself. I mean, I've had my eye on the ball trying to sell what I've been making. And I've thought that, for me, the public relations definitely took second place. But I'm beginning to change my attitude about that now.
Well, where do you sell your clothes? How much do you sell here and how much do you sell abroad?
We sell now about 40% here, 60% abroad. The export market has increased enormously in the last 2 years for me. I mean, 2 years ago, it was almost virtually 100% here. Mm. But since I've been showing abroad now, we've built up the export side of the business.
Now, you've actually promoted your own name, haven't you? You've sold
Yes.
your own clothes. What were the difficulties? How difficult was it for you in the beginning?
It was more than difficult. It was impossible. And that's why I tried to concentrate on giving good service and good value so that if people didn't take the label out of the dresses, because when I first started, people did cut the label out of the dresses. They would tell their customers this is a Paris model, because it meant so much then. I mean, you couldn't say back in the 50s this was an English designer, they wouldn't have sold it.
And yet you do a lot of good business in France, don't you?
Oh, now I do, yes. So since I've been showing in Paris, yes, a lot of French customers.
So how would you rate, then, the British designer now, the importance and how much the world wants the British designer and his clothes?
Well, you've only got to see the crowds that come to London for the exhibitions that happen here twice a year. I mean, the place is absolutely mobbed with people from abroad.
Well, Wendy Dagworthy, you're one of, well, you've been called one of the keenest design talents in Britain, actually, and you're just starting. How did you start, then, and how difficult was it for you to get your name known?
Well, I started very, very small. I borrowed money from a bank, I mean, a few hundred pounds, and I gradually built it up from there. It was difficult, and it still is. Just running the whole business is a
non-stop
job.
Do you sell abroad
too?
Do you sell your clothes?
Oh, yes.
Is that important to a designer, or wouldn't it be better to sort of be a success just here in Britain?
Oh, no, it's very important, because there is a limit to what you can sell in London and sort of around England. And you just can't run a business just on those sales. So you have to sell abroad.
Now, you've actually joined a group. You sell in... What's the advantage of that? Rather than sort of doing your own show by yourself, you joined a group of other designers.
Yes. Well, for one thing, it makes it a lot easier for the buyers that are coming over here, for the foreign buyers, because we're all in one place and they don't have to sort of go all over London searching for people. It's nice sharing with a lot of people as well.
Do you sense now that that the British designer is beginning to make an impact? Is it beginning to happen for you?
Oh, yes, definitely. London's coming up very, very quickly, I think. That we're becoming very important.
Well, ANNETTE Worsley-Taylor, you are a promoter, and probably that's one of the reasons why London is coming up, because you're helping the young designers, and you are a promoter of the London Designer Collections. Why would you think it was necessary to start such a group?
I think that in the early 70s, we had got a very bad reputation for cheap clothes, badly delivered. People didn't actually recognise us as a designer country seriously, with merchandise which is expensive and well-made and well-delivered. I had a company myself at that point, and I had three designers working for me. Mm. I desperately wanted to sell abroad. I felt we had the merchandise, which was right, for instance, for stores in the States. And there was really nowhere to actually show those clothes in a proper way. There were big trade fairs, and I tried it a few times. We were next door to cheap and cheerful people, and people died when they saw our prices. They didn't understand what we were about. I suppose that at that point, rather than go to Paris, I thought, well, perhaps we could do something here. And we did, and we started a very small group. But it was very quality conscious, it was design conscious, and I suppose that really is what kicked the whole thing off.
Mm. Would you like to see much more promotion of British designers?
Yes, I would. I mean, we've done on very little money. I mean, the London Designer Collections is a non-profit making association, and designers who really may be selling a lot more, but they're still not heavily financed, are chipping in themselves to do something as beautifully as they can. But at the end of the day, nobody helps us here. We get very, very little government money, a tiny fraction towards some of the overseas mailing shots, etc. And I think we've got to the stage now when people are beginning to treat us seriously. But if we really want to make an impact, we've got to do many more promotions abroad. I mean, the Italians do it, the French do it, their governments have backed them, their textile industries have backed them. And here, really, we get very little support. And after all, clothing is one of the biggest exports in this country. Our figures are enormous and have jumped up enormously over the last couple of years. And I think now we've got to really push it and do it seriously.
Prudence, I think you agree with that, don't you? I think that you would like to see much more promotion.
Yes, I would. I used to think that it was better for the designers to make it on their own in the groups that they have formed, but I've now come round to the point which Annette's just made. I really do think that the government will have to take some sort of official, however, hopefully, backseat promotion in this. It's quite unfair that our designers, who are fragmented enough and undercapitalised enough anyway, have to compete in world markets against either clothes which are made far, far more cheaply because they can be produced at that price for all sorts of economic reasons, or also are just so very, very badly shown. I mean, I could never decide after the collections whether it's all the fuss and bazaars and being knocked down flat trying to get in to see someone's show. And at the end of the day, what they actually have in new ideas often doesn't match up to us. Yet you see, these three designers who've got with you today, we've all but just been clobbered by the international press for the last lot of London showings, saying that they're dull and London's finished and everything else. And it's for someone like myself who's been very, very anxious to promote British fashion over many years, well, it's heartbreaking.
How do you feel about that, Mary? Because you've actually managed quite nicely on your own, thank you very much. Would you like much more promotion and much more sort of...
Oh, I certainly would. Well, I belong to something called the Clothing Export Council, who are the official organisation for promoting British fashion abroad, and we're subsidised by the government. Well, now, the Prêt-à-Porter, which is the big fashion fair that takes place in Paris twice a year, the expenses for people who are showing for the third time have now been cut by half. Once you were subsidised to the full 100% for the cost of your stand space and stand decoration, now you are only subsidised if you're showing there for the first or second time. And it is a very, very expensive proposition.
Mm. What about the manufacturing industry? I mean, Wendy, would you like to perhaps to be backed, promoted and by a manufacturer, for example?
No, personally I wouldn't, because I like being by myself.
You see, in France or Italy, she would be. I mean, a designer like Wendy would have been snapped up by a big textile firm or a big manufacturer.
Mm. But why wouldn't you like to be then, Wendy?
Because I like to run it by myself, really.
Are you not afraid, perhaps, of change or being made to change your designs?
Yes, I think that's probably what it is. You do something and they say, oh, well, I think it'd be better, it'd sell better if you take that off. And I think it's a shame when that does happen. I mean, that's probably just me. I mean, it makes things a lot easier if you have a backer. Mm-hmm. But
why are we a bit behind then, Prudence, in this country? Are we a bit embarrassed by fashion, do you think? Because it's obviously very lucrative in France.
I think we are. I think it comes from a long Puritan heritage, and if you create something, it's supposed to have a practical end product. And there's the absolutely classic story about the invention of rayon. It was invented in this country and used for the filaments of light bulbs. Then it was invented, too, it was discovered 2 years later in France and used for ladies' underwear, and they've sold millions of yards of it ever since. It's absolutely typical of this country.
Is it also typical that we are wasting our talent, do you think? I mean, have we got the talent, and B, do we educate that talent?
We've got the talent, and we also spend more money than any country in the world training young designers, most of whom go promptly abroad and get used by other people's industries. But it must be said, devoted though I am to many of the students, a great many of them are both very unprofessional and very self-indulgent. And if we want the industry in this country to be bigger, we've got to be more professional and more prepared to, you know, get together, not just split off into lots of little groups and go off into rose-covered cottages and do our own thing. There is that aspect of the market. We've made a place in America by making short runs of beautiful clothes. Murray's the other end. He makes magnificent clothes and for a much bigger market.
Don't you think you ought to share your name, Murray, a bit more? I mean, it's all very well sort of being the best-known, unknown designer, don't you?
Yes. I am principally concerned with selling to professional buyers. After all, I have a dress business, I have a lot of people to support, a lot of people depend on what I turn out twice a year, and I'm very conscious of that. I feel that the public relations for oneself, it's something that you either want or you don't want. I'm very happy without it, frankly. But on the other hand, I do see that it's important as we get more professional.
I think also, it must help your stockists. I mean, the more publicity you get at the end of the day, the better it is for the people who are selling your clothes. And I think it's very important for designers, as I'm sure you must agree, to actually work with the stores very much. And I think that perhaps if in the States they actually worked more with British designers, and supposing the large store group who's buying a designer, you know, promoted it coast to coast, did in-store appearances and really got the customer to relate.
Right.
I think that would be a very important step in that direction.
Prudence, if you were in charge then, if you tomorrow you were given the sort of promotion of British fashion, and let's face it, it's beginning to happen and perhaps we've reached the stage, how would you go about promoting it? I mean, what would you actually do?
But would I wear a suit like you, Mary,
yeah.
to start?
Mm-hmm.
That'd be terrifying, wouldn't it?
Yes, it would.
Oh, I think there's a lot to be done. It's an emotional question because fashion's such a personal and invidious thing. But I think there is a great deal which could be done to pull the industry together in this country. But the number one thing is to take it seriously and to balance what we've got to offer against what the rest of the world offers and see where our place in the market is. And when, after that, I say, go about it professionally. We're lovely gifted amateurs, but the amateur comes a bit before the gifted in some instances.
Mm. Well, thank you all very much indeed. I really enjoyed it. Let's hope that the British fashions go on apace. And if you're in the high street and you're buying clothes, why don't you take a look at the label and perhaps try Brian Bishish?